الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدًا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدًا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
الحمد لله الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله عباد الله أوصيكم وإياي بتقوى الله العظيم ولزوم طاعته وأحذركم ونفسي من عصيانه ومخالفة أمره ونهيه لقوله تعالى فمن يعمل مثقال ذرة خيرا يره ومن يعمل مثقال ذرة شرا يره وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له هو الأول والآخر والظاهر والباطن وهو بكل شيء عليم وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا وقدوتنا ومعلمنا محمد عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله نبي بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حتى أتاه اليقين فصلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين أما بعد يا عباد الله brothers and sisters we Muslims always say that our message is universal And to clarify that, we have to look at the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, where you read a very important statement in verse number 13 in Surah Al-Hujurat, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all people. So Allah is not talking to the Arabs. Allah is not talking to the people of Mecca. He's talking to people. And people mean every single human being. All people, we have created you. That's Allah. We have created you from male and female. And made you into tribes and peoples. Tribes and nation, shu'uban wa qabail. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who has created human being from male and female and made them into tribes and nations. It could have been one nation, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala well decided that people have to be so many different nations. Indeed, those are the best in the sight of Allah are the most pious. Inna akramakum, the most honorable. In the sight of Allah are those who are the most piety, the most pious. In this verse, in this statement, in this universal statement, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided so many different facts. To understand this ayah, we have to look at the beginning of it, that we are the creation of Allah, and it's Allah the one who decides to have male and females. Allah could have said, we have created you and that's it. Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually pointing to the fact that we are male and females just to eliminate from human mentality and human thoughts any sign or any thoughts of discrimination, starting between male and female, black and white, race and different race, nation and nation, any different or any differences can be between people has no consideration in Islam, and it can be no way used as a standard for differentiation or being better than the others. It can be no way used as a statement or as a standard for judging each other. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made any form of discrimination with this ayah, any form of discrimination, haram, means absolutely forbidden. On a level of action, on a level of oral actions, or even a level of thoughts. And of course, to understand that, you have to look at the Islamic history and look at how the Muslim, the original Muslim, in the era of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how the people act and how did they react and what was the attitude of Islam through Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was the attitude of Islam through the Prophet himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to give you an example. One day, one of the companions, his name Abu Dharr al-Ghafari radiallahu anhu. Abu Dharr, one of the first people who actually converted to Islam and followed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca. But before him, there was a black slave. His name is Bilal ibn Rabah, who was the first among the slaves to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was Abyssinian, Ethiopian, black, slave, no value in the society. Can be sold, can be bought, can be killed, can be done anything, no obligations. But after following Islam, one day Abu Dharr has an argument with Bilal and he said, Yabn al-Sawda. He called him, he just said something. He called him, you are the son of the black mother, Yabn al-Sawda. Bilal radiallahu anhu rushed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he said, O Prophet of Allah, this is what Abu Dharr have said to me. The Prophet was so furious and he called Abu Dharr over and he said, Ya Abu Dharr, O Abu Dharr, you are a man with that who still have a remain of ignorance. You're a man, naka rajulun fika jahiliya. You're a man who still have a remain of jahiliya, the era that pre-Islamic era, al-jahiliya, with this kind of concepts, with this kind of thoughts, that you're looking at people with their colors, or who they are, where they come from. Innaka mri'un fika jahiliya. You still have remains of ignorance. You still have remains of jahiliya. Then Abu Dharr, when he realized that he has to switch and change these evil thoughts, he didn't know what to do, how to apologize to Bilal. He rushed to Bilal and he put his cheek on the floor and said, Bilal, I want you to step on my other cheeks, just to let me feel how that hurts. And Bilal al-Habashi, Bilal himself, is a symbolism for how Islam has re-transformed the society from being so many different classes to an absolutely humanitarian society. So if you look at Umar ibn al-Khattab, he's the second caliphate in Islam, and he was actually the one who forms the state of Islam, how it should look like in terms of administration. When he used to see Bilal around, he used to say, هَذَا سَيِّدُنَا وَأَعْتَقَهُ سَيِّدُنَا. This man is our master. This man, Bilal, the black guy, the black slave, is our master now. He's our master, and he was sent free by our master, referring to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet, when he reached Mecca, returned to Mecca, everyone at that position, in that situation, wanted to stand out, to show his superiority, how close he is to the Prophet, how good he is to Islam. He wants to stand out in that certain situation because it's an amazing turning point in human life, where the Prophet, who was actually running away from Mecca, immigrating from Mecca, people were after him, to get rid of him. He's returning as a hero. And he was so much welcome. So everyone wants to have that kind of position. He wants to stand out in that position. But what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, what Muhammad did, he called Bilal. And his Bilal claim on the top of Al-Kaaba, the holiest spot for Muslims in the earth, it was Al-Kaaba. So Rasulullah, the Prophet Muhammad, he called Bilal and told him, go climb on the top of Al-Kaaba. You are on the top of Al-Kaaba, ya Bilal, now. And your foot is above of every master in Mecca. That is Bilal. Bilal is symbolism of sending people free. Free from slavery, free from bad thoughts, free from being followed by following anyone else but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He said, when He made this statement, we have created you, Allah insisted to mention that no matter who you are, what your color, male or female, what your race, what your culture, you are human being and you are creation of Allah. No differences. No differences. And any form or any type of discrimination in Islam is absolutely forbidden. Absolutely forbidden, and Allah will not accept that. Even if you have the thought in your mind, Allah will not accept that. And this is up to Allah to judge. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided with His will that people will be in two tribes and nations. Allah in different places say, Allah could have done, if Allah has willed, He could have made people into one nation. But He wanted them to be different nations. وَلِذَٰلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ. For that He has created them. Why, ya Allah? What is the wisdom behind having people different nations? Well, keep in mind, people are not living in one place. People are living from this end of the earth to the other end of the earth, in different environment, in different climates, in different geography, different history. Everyone has their own concern. Every nation has their own problems to solve. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knew this is going to happen since Adam. He knew, and that's His will. So with that going to happen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that we have to actually believe in something, that we have to get to know each other. Now, I have to explain this in Arabic too. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِتَعَارَفُوا. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, لِتَعَارَفُوا, it means just to get to know each other. Hello, my name is so-and-so, and my name is so-and-so, then we know each other. That's it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they didn't say, لِتَعَارَفُوا. He said, لِتَعَارَفُوا. And that opens the meaning of knowledge, of knowing each other, to the widest open door. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that we need to know each other, we need to understand each other, we need to get to know the knowledge of each other. So in the Islamic history, in the Abbasian Khilafah, the president himself, the Khalifa, used to say, whoever translate a book from any other nations or previous nation knowledge, I will give him the way of this of his book gold. So you bring me your translation to Arabic, from Greek to Arabic, from Roman to Arabic, from Egyptian, Old Egyptian to Arabic, from Persian to Arabic, from Indian to Arabic, any nation, from Chinese to Arabic. Give me your translation for that knowledge, I'll weigh it and give you the same way gold. Why? Because they realize that our job is to get to know each other. I don't need enough to know that you are from China or you're from India. I need to know what is happening there. How you think. What your understanding for life. What is your philosophy. What is your point of view for life. Now, in order also to understand that meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to understand, which is actually a life concept, that we need to know each other. If you want to understand it and realize what's going on, you have to look at the opposite meaning. So if we don't know each other, if we don't understand each other, what's going to happen? It's going to be ignorance. So I have ignorance toward the others. It means I don't know nothing about them. And naturally, human beings, when they don't know something, when they're ignorant toward the others, they actually have fear. It's naturally, people are afraid of what they don't know. They're afraid of people who they don't know. And they get to the point, they want to be segregated. They get to the point, they want to be different. They get to the point, they have conflict. They get to the point, they want to hate each other. And that's what's happening. Misunderstanding is the main reason of the conflict in this globe, in the human history and the present. So for people to get to know each other, they have to open doors and open minds and understand each other. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking you straightforward. This is part of the Islamic culture. It's part of the Islamic concept that we're open to understand each other. And that's why when you say Islam, you don't refer to a race, you don't refer to a nation. You refer to a global nation. Now in our gathering here, we have people from every color, every nation. They have, I am sure they have no differences in their heart toward each other. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لِتَعَارَفُوا, get to know each other. And one of the things that Muslims nowadays actually are suffering from, that people are not open much or enough to understand them. What I have noticed, that people read a lot about Islam, but they never bother to read Islam itself. It's very different when you read about something and you read it itself. It's way different. People are willing to hear about the Muslim from everyone, but then they're willing to hear the Muslims. And that's part of why we're suffering in this world. If people are open-minded the way we are, it will be way more coherent life, way more coherent discussions and arguments. It's going to be way better life for everyone. Inna akramakum 'inda Allahi atqakum. With this last part of this ayah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself decides that the most honorable ones are the ones that have piety toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It means what? It means the standard of the evaluation of peoples, how we judge people, how we evaluate each other, has nothing to do with our color, our thoughts, our race, what we eat, what we wear. It has to do with what we act. Even the amount of faith in our hearts, it's only in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because taqwa, piety, means the actions, what you do. So I only evaluate people with their actions, but I don't evaluate people with their thoughts or with their feelings. It's not my job to do that. It's up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do that. And he's the one who's going to take care of that. So Islam, التقييم تقييم أفعال وليس تقييم أشخاص. Judgment is not, it's only for action and it's not for people. We don't judge people in Islam. It's haram, it's absolutely forbidden to judge people because this one is rich, this one is in power, this one is black or this one is white. You only judge actions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at your color. إن الله لا ينظر إلى صوركم ولا إلى أعمالكم ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم. الله ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم. Allah does not look at your color or your race. He created you that way. You never had the chance to choose your color. You didn't choose your race. You didn't choose your parents. When to be born, where to be born. It's up to Allah. So Allah is not going to judge you according to that. Allah is going to judge you according to your actions. And our role as or our authority as a human being, that we judge only actions. You don't come to someone and you tell him you're less than anyone else because your color is so-and-so. You have no authority to do that. On the contrary, it's a major sin. It's a major sin in Islam. So the message, which is a universal message of Islam, that we always say, we have a universal message. Yes, we have it, but we have to prove it. We have the proof through the history. We have the proof in the text, the holy text in Quran and the tradition of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But also it's our duty, brothers and sisters, that we have to prove that through our actions, through our attitudes, and through the way we react to people and how we deal with people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the understanding of our deen and give us the ability to show it to everyone. إِنَّهُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ قَدِيرٌ أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَيَا فَوْزَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ. الحمد لله المنعوت بصفات التنزيه والكمال وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله الكبير المتعال وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله سمي الخصال. عباد الله اتقوا الله فإنكم عليه تعرضون. وأخلصوا له الأعمال فإنكم عليها محاسبون. واعلموا أن الله قد صلى على نبيه في كتابه المكنون حيث قال وهو أصدق القائلين: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. لبيك اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم لا تدع لنا في هذا اليوم ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا ضالا إلا هديته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا مسافرا إلا بخير إلى أهله رددته، ولا طالب علم إلا أنجحت مقاصده يا رب العالمين. اللهم اجعلنا هداة مهديين لا ضالين ولا مضلين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم، واستغفروه يغفر لكم، وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر، ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون.